Good evening, everyone. I'm going to speak about 48 Degrees Public Art Ecology, which was an experiment in 2008. Yeah, 13 years from now. And I'd like to just park a quotation by Lucy Lippard and park that with you. 2008. From the 1960s through most of the 1990s, the left considered environmentalism to be soft politics, while the bold action of Greenpeace and the extremes of eco-terrorism had to be acknowledged, for the most part, those who supposedly cared more for the earth and its creations and creatures than for people's revolutions were perceived as acting from a kind of political suburbia. Today, sparked by indisputable proof of human agency in climate change, the environment is in the center foreground. It has become the radical edge. Today, of course, it is a cultural emergency. In 2007, I was invited by Stefan Dreyer of the Goethe Institute to conceive and curate a project in city spaces of Delhi. And GTZ, which is a leading environment organization, when they came on board and agreed to co-finance the project, the term environmental issues and around, you know, was added to the remit. So pretty much the format was given to me, and it was within this that I had to think about what to do. I have to say that I'd never ever produced, worked on such a big project. I felt extremely vulnerable, and it was, I really approached it as an experiment, and it was an experiment. There has been a very long history of very strong political art making in India. In the late 80s and 1990s, it was mainly communal tensions and conflicts that triggered artists, activists, and intellectuals to claim public attention, thus shaping an alternative public space of dissent, contestation, and dialogue. Sehmat, founded in 1989, was such a radical, critical initiative involving artists, political activists, academics to stage political and legal confrontations in public. And just now, Sharmila spoke about the work that Open Circle was doing. And I'd like to say that even at Khoj, we were doing a lot of site-specific work, and we'd started being embedded in Khirki Village in 2005 to work what we now term as socially engaged practice or community art. So the process had begun to kind of step out of the white cube and begin to look at what those strategies might be. So 48 Degrees was not the first public art intervention at all. But set across 10 public sites with 25 artistic commissions, it was, however, certainly the first condensed event at a scale that challenged notions of both art and public space in Delhi, with a focus on ecology and environment. Envisioned as a festival because of the duration, 48 Degrees Public Art Ecology was a 12-day experiment set within the capital metropolitan city of Delhi. The ambition of this project was to interrogate, through a number of art interventions and projects, the ecology of the city through the prism of contemporary art. Situated in various public spaces around the city, it was an attempt to draw complex and diverse public into the world of this critical imaginary. What constitutes public space in a city like such as Delhi? For just as it is difficult to speak of one civil society, public space in India too is equally compartmentalized and even restricted. It is certainly not bound by a sense of shared space and equal access for all. What is precisely missing in the Indian cultural context is the notion of universality of access, the idea that an activity is open to all, irrespective of their social attributes. It is clear that with rapid development, urban public space has fallen a victim to increasing privatization of public domains, greater exclusivity in urban access. Public spaces as they exist are often regarded as being unpleasant, unsafe, and neglected areas. By radically transforming a site for a short period of time, giving it new use and meaning, would it be possible to choreograph a different pattern of urban space to create a map of that area other than that is currently understood? 48 Degrees was a contemporary art project. While it hoped to challenge the oldest and most obvious forms of officially sanctioned public art, monuments, memorials, and civic statuary, it also needed to ask what contemporary art in the public domain means, especially in our part of the world, for those who experience it, if anything. Would it get lost in the spectacle that is Delhi? Would it need mediation, and what kind of mediation? And finally, 48 Degrees was also an invitation to participating artists to experiment with their own practice and with spaces hardly considered as exhibition spaces before. 48C was thus a proposition and an experiment. some of the infrastructure and how we began to even think about it. It was a hugely collaborative project. And one of the biggest challenges was one of access, physical, artistic, intellectual. Negotiating the 1,500 square kilometer sprawl of the city of Delhi, and I'm not going to go on about what Delhi was in 2008, but I must mention that it was completely being rebuilt in a frenzy because of the upcoming Commonwealth Games in 2010. So everywhere you looked, there was a debris and there was some new construction coming up. The first question was really, you know, how do you begin to even think of what these public spaces might be? The Delhi Metro, the then work in progress, urban showpiece and icon of the 21st century in Delhi, emerged as a potential navigational strategy across the city, and all the sites were located along the newly opened yellow site, which cut across old Delhi and colonial parts of Delhi. The majority of the sites were located at the, you know, and this is when I invited Arunav Dasgupta. He's an urbanist, urban planner from SPA, and he had an urban resource group. And it was them, him and his students, who then kind of developed and unpacked and did a lot of research and created like what one would call thick sites and really looked at the geographical, historical, social, the movement of people along all these sites. Yeah, and the majority of these sites were located at the shifting crossroads of public space transformation and outside the vicinity of New Delhi's financially booming and richer neighborhoods and commercial districts. It included Roshnara Bagh, Kashmiri Gate, Ramlila Grounds, and Chandni Chowk, which have been spatially and mentally disconnected from the maps, mobilities, and gazes of the predominantly elite and more affluent middle-class South Delhi. Temporarily, this changed to some extent with the new connectivities availed by the metro railways at the time when 48C made place. In Old Delhi, and you know, when you looked at the yellow line at that point, it really started from the center, CP, which was Rajiv Chowk, and it cut across upwards. It was the colonial, it went through Barakamba Road, which was the Barakamba Road, which was, and Jantar Mantar in that area, which was largely the commercial area, the protest site, and then went into Old Delhi, which was Ramlila Grounds, which was at the in-between space between Old Delhi and the colonial part of Delhi, and then into Old Delhi, which was, we had Roshnara and Chandni Chowk, and it kind of stopped there. But it was also, each of these sites had a different understanding of them. I mean, Shiba spoken at great length at the project that she was able to find in Chandni Chowk at the Delhi Public Library, which was once all water, as she said. And so it was really looking at some of the ecology of the sites, but equally the historicity of it. I could have gone on about all the sites, but I thought I'd just talk about some of the problems that we had, because Geeta also said speak about the infrastructure problems, which I thought I should. Probably there was one of the biggest was one of, you know, there were many problems and many challenges because we really didn't have something to set before us. We didn't know what to follow. They were not small projects which we would do at Khoj, which was really one person artist who would go out, temporarily take a space and go away, as we did in Khirki. This was something that was supposed to stay and we needed permissions. And that's, I think, when we realized that there was really no public space. So, you know, the idea of what constitutes public art and public space radically differs between bureaucrats and, of course, our 48C representatives. From the land holding agency, the municipal corporation, DDA, Delhi Development Agency, police departments in different zones of Delhi, traffic police, horticulture departments, Archaeological Survey of India. I mean, the list of departmental legalese that we had to go through for each and every project, and we had 25 of them, it was really a struggle to bring the government on the same page. Having said that, the fact that it was you know, around ecology and it was about environment and it was funded by, and we weren't asking them for money, in some ways made it plausible and palatable for the government. Because we were able to kind of twist it and say, you know, for public welfare, public good. I mean, really, that was the way we had to work. But it was very difficult to get every single, and you needed all these permissions for every single project and every single site. The other terrible thing that happened was on November 24th, 2008, 3 weeks before the opening of the festival, the Taj Hotel in Mumbai was held under siege by terrorists, where over 100 people lost their lives and several were injured. It was a very difficult time for us as we were sure that we would lose our funding, we lost a major site, the India Gate lawns, where Vivan was actually showing his work, and it had to be reconfigured and replaced. How? It was supposed to be site-specific. So it was really kind of rethinking with urban, you know, with Arunava, the urban designers, to kind of look at where we could then place some of this work. The artists and artworks, and I think, can we just carry on with this? Because I'm not going to speak too much because you've been seeing them. But just to say that the art projects covered a range of practice and mediums, and I think that was something that we really was very willful. A lot of it was very, was spectacle, was large, and I think it was also because the artists felt that we had the funds to be able to create that. That was, and the way we did it was with all the sites, we tried to cluster 4 to 5 projects around that, which spoke to the site in the closest way. So from large site-specific sculptures as those of Krishnaraj Chonnat, which you may have seen, you know, which was the crane and the tree, which was really one of, oh, this, which was the crane and tree. Pardon? Anyway, then we had Hobbit and Zok, who, yeah, just can you go to that? Before that, is that? Huh. Crane and tree. And this was really responding to the fact that this overzealous drive to build the metro, so it was, you know, what is development and for whose sake, to build the metro, a lot of trees had been knocked off Barakamba Road. And so this was a very simple device of putting, hanging this up. Of course, you can imagine as curators, we had to find a dead tree, because we couldn't kill a tree to put it up as an artwork. So, you know, we had to find a dead tree in order to bring this out and put it up. But what was even more important was Navjot's work under that, which was 2 videos, where she spent a lot of time and in her, the way that she works, which is very dialogical, and working with the community, where she'd spent a lot of time talking to everybody, including the chaiwalas and the small vendors, food vendors on Barakamba Road, as to how, you know, what it meant, what development meant to them, and what it meant to have those trees not there, etc. So it's a much more deeply, I mean, you can read all about that because we're going to do that. This is Hobbits and Zok, which was at Kashmiri Gate, and there were a cluster of 3 projects. This was a lighthouse, almost, and this was, Kashmiri Gate is the closest area site to the river that once flows, to the Jamuna River. And Hobbits and Zok, which are German artists, had come in for research visits, which is what we did for every artist, and spent a lot of time taking underwater photography of the Yamuna from the Yamunotri, and actually presented that work there. And it became a site for a lot of conversation as to what that meant, what was this strange thing doing there. And of course, there was sculpture by Subodh. We had an installation covering an entire landscape, and I think you've seen that by Mary Miss, which was the Roshanara Garden. It was a social interaction work which included sculpture, video, photography, which was Atul Bhalla. This was a canister in Kashmiri Gate. Opening up the ASI site was very difficult. And starting from the metro station, there were these things of, have you ever touched the river? Have you ever seen the river? Which brought you all the way to the Chabil. This was Christiane, which was a wish machine, one of her projects, and it was a very interactive piece set in one of the malls at the metro stations, where it talked about consumption, but when you pressed it, it was really asking what you needed, and it was, you know, calmness, this kind of oil, etc. So it was a little tongue-in-cheek, but it got people talking about what consumption meant to them. And then, of course, we had the large sculptures, we had Vivan's work, which was also using water bottle caps, large, which became a flotage, and which then you subsequently took to float in the river Jamuna. But it also had very beautiful work by camp, where they spent many, many months working with training local rickshaw drivers on how to tell the story of Roshanara, which was once a booming center for small industry and had been thrown out, you know, because it said it was a polluting and it was a dead derelict district. So it was really taking them to sites like the ice factory and retelling you the story through their own voice in these beautiful cycles. And of course, you know, that went on for a long time. I mean, these were walks, or rather cycle rides, that you would have with beautiful songs when you put on your, they had these lovely earphones, and you would walk through the space. And then, of course, we used a lot of specific video installation by Andrej and Ravi Agarwal. Ravi's work started at Mandi House and led. It was a huge thing where he was talking about the extinction of vultures and also extinction in itself. And it led all the way to up to the Natural History Museum, where there's the one stuffed vulture. And then, of course, you had Amar Kanwar's work, which used text, poetry, and light boxes at Jantar Mantar. Extremely, extremely... it was the start of the sovereign forest. After 48C, it's not possible to mention the number of public art initiatives that have taken place in Delhi since 2008, but only to mention a few that intimately link the city to the notion of ecology and environment, because that's what Khoj was doing for a long time, was the negotiating routes. The ecologies of the byways was started by Khoj in 2010 and has invited projects on a nationwide level looking at urban challenges. Funded by the Norwegian embassy since 2010, we had about 4 years of in-context public art ecology, which also took public art to new spaces, including shopping malls, although on a much smaller scale. And one of the most impressive projects that followed 48C was Yamuna Elbe, which was co-curated by activist and artist Ravi Agarwal and Till Krauss from Hamburg, again with the support from the Goethe Institute. It reflected the different ways in which rivers shape urban public space, invite discussions about the controversial relationship of different stakeholders involved in space and placemaking in today's times, be they activists, curators, artists, government bureaucrats, private investors, or school children. And even during 48 degrees, we tried to give it the element of a festival. There were a lot of... there were ecological bus rides, and there was even a marathon, a cycle marathon, public screenings on public walls through those 10 days. And it was to try, and a large 3-day seminar, which invited architects, and including government. That's when we realized that government does not see eye to eye. And more recently, literally 6 months ago, the Delhi Urban Arts Commission, in its recent series of meetings, is planning to revive the law that states 2% of all public building projects must be put towards public art. The access to multiple public spaces will remain a contestation. We don't know what that will be, what kind of art will come up, but at least the conversation has begun.